God bless the flag, we all beating our chest. When it's peace, it's the same old game, the same old players, same old names.
Right.
My skin is my sin.
My skin is my
sin. My skin is my sin.
And actually, man, I've been thinking about this, man, and I just could not come up with a sufficient enough introduction from my standpoint to show this brother's greatness. I want to read a little bit from his website, ktthearchdegree.com. In the beginning, born in the Virgin Islands of Christiansted, St. Croix, Kamani Tate's involvement with health and nutrition has been inspirational from the start. At the precipice of birth, Mother Annette Thomas faced fetal complications with extremely low iron levels. Refusing the blood transfusion, Annette reached out to Dr. Sabi, who gave her Maya, a tonic increasing hemoglobin, which proved to save both their lives. Annette soon became a wife of Dr. Sabi, educating herself in the uses of herbs and all natural healing agents. Soon thereafter, Usha Herbal Research Institute, the brainchild of Thomas and Sabi, established itself as a wellness organization specializing in the research and development of African herbal healing modalities. The reason I wanted to bring that up is I wanted you to see the roots of greatness this brother has. And without further ado, I want to bring in KT, the Arts Degree. What's good, fam?
Greetings, brother. What's going on, man?
Not much, man. How's life?
Man, it's beautiful, man. Thank you for that great introduction right there, man. Like, it's funny hearing it back when people say it because it sounds so big and so grand, but, you know, fish don't know they wet, meaning, you know, going through it, you don't see it, so you just see it
right.
As life, you know. But I definitely appreciate you making those points to let the family know, you know, who's on the line. But thank you, brother.
No doubt, man. No, and thank you, brother. You know, truly an honor and our privilege. My name is Jobs. We got Jerome on the line, and I do believe Knowledge is still on the line with us, man.
Yo, peace, family.
Peace.
Peace, KT. Just, you know, sweeping up the hairs in the barbershop, Jake, getting it ready. You know what I'm saying?
Already.
I hear that. The barbershop,
so,
though.
I know you got an event coming up. You want to tell us about that? I want to make sure that we get that out the way first and foremost.
Oh, no doubt. On Saturday, December 17th, at 6 p.m., the doors are going to be opening at Nicholas Bookstore's new location, 1396 Fulton Street in Restoration Plaza. And there, I'm going to be doing something kind of unprecedented. I'm not just going to decode one movie. I'm not just going to decode two movies. No, I'm decoding three movies with a preview of a fourth one. So I'm getting a little advantageous out here. And I'm going to use these three movies as a means to disseminate some real powerful information in regards to health, wellness, physiology, metaphysics, occultism, language. I'm going to kind of just put it all together. And people are going to get like a four-year course in a matter of 3 hours.
Damn.
And for those that can't come in person to see it and get themselves their own physical seat, they can reserve their seat in the comfort of their own home by going to eventbrite.com, typing in KT the Arts Degree, and getting their ticket. And they'll get a code where they can see the live stream in high definition, not just any live stream. You know, with the blurry, and the buffering, and the lagging, and the pixelating. No, we're talking about that Sunday ticket when you're trying to catch that.
That's dope.
So you just got to go to eventbrite.com for that.
That is very dope. All right, bro. So you've been doing the decoding, and I see you did everything from, and correct me if I'm wrong, but from the Black Panthers to Doctor Strange. What was the first movie you decoded, and what made you want to decode it?
Say that again. You said what was the first movie?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I've been breaking movies down for a minute, but the first one that I really got serious on was V for Vendetta, which was a movie done by the Wachowski brothers, who obviously everybody knows, did The Matrix. But I something about this movie just really did something to me, because it had everything to deal with pretty much the society we live in right now and the steps that need to be taken in order to change the paradigm. You know, a world and an earth are two different things. You know, the earth is a physical location where we live, but the world is a paradigm. It's a state of mind. It's kind of what all society agrees upon.
Okay.
And I enjoyed about this film was they showed how to go about changing your world, how to go about changing the environment around you, and what sacrifices need to be taken. And there was just a lot of symbolism dealing with the man and the woman in there that I really appreciated. So I got an opportunity from Black Dot when he had his website first got cracking, you know, when he was doing the hip-hop Decoded that just dropped. And by the way, big shout-out to Black Dot, because Hollywood Decoded only has that name because I was inspired by hip-hop Decoded by Black Dot. Okay?
Dope.
Yeah. He turned me into the movie man, really, because on 666, which was June 6, 2006, I was in a situation where I was working in a doctor's office. I was on bone densitometry machines. I was on ultrasound. I was dealing with segmented pressure devices. And a situation took place where I had to leave my work. I couldn't work there any longer. And I had made a agreement with myself that I was never going to work for anyone else again. I was going to be my own entrepreneur, because by that time, I just felt like I'd be able to handle it. So Black Dot actually helped me out, because I had a new child that was just born.
Uh-huh.
I was a brand new father. And with the child just being born and the fact that I had no work, it was like, okay, I have a great idea, but how am I going to get from, you know, kind of being with nothing to being in this position where, you know, I could do the things I want to do? Well, he really helped me, because he sent me a box of about 300 DVDs, about 60 to 70 different titles of all of the conscious community. We're talking about every elder from A to Z that you could think of, all the classics, all the greats. And I was able to take those masters and turn that, you know, into a business, you know, when I was in Atlanta. So that was Black Dot. He didn't ask for nothing. He didn't ask for anything. He just sent it to me. You know what I'm saying? So just
That's a beautiful soul,
beautiful person, just somebody who believed in me. And Hollywood Decoded came out of that. You know what I'm saying? Definitely. So I would definitely have to credit Black Dot, you know, with that. Now, with that being said, you know, I did V for Vendetta. I did Superman Returns. Those are like in the beginning. But I really started catching momentum when I did an event with my brother Red Pill called Hollywood is
shout
CNN
out to Red Pill.
CNN is Hollywood. Oh, big shout out to Red Pill. Big shout out to Scorpion Kings, doing very well. Go to Bandcamp. Go on, get your copy. You know what I'm saying? Or you could get your hard copy, you know, from Red, please. He'll definitely be in the building on Saturday at this event also. And this is part of a trinity that my brothers and I did, where we started with the Fear of a Black Amor Messiah with Red.
Mm-hmm.
Then I did Birth of a Nation Decoded, and then Blue followed with the Blood Moon ritual that he did. And this is kind of a culmination of those three. And then once I'm done, Blue's going to follow, and then Red's going to follow after me again. So we're going to do kind of like a mirror, where we both doing, you know, we're doing like six events, each of us busting out two, you know. So this is part of that whole series. But we
and
did
shout out to Red
together
for being our first winner of the Conscious Olympics, by the way, too.
Oh, yes, I heard about that. But I already knew it. I told him. I said, if I was part of that, I would have been on your team. Would have been no way, because whatever team Red is on, going to be the team that wins. My money is on Red. If you want to be in the black, you got to bet on Red. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, let me ask you this question, bro. Doctor Strange, I didn't get a chance to see it the very end, so I'm not sure if you addressed what was in the tea. Did you address it in that one? If not, what would be your thoughts on what was in the tea? Because I had a conversation with a brother when we drove back from Baltimore, and he had a really good thought on that, so I wanted to get your opinion.
Well, what was in the tea could have been just about anything, but it fell within the context of, you know, an entheogen. It fell into the context of an herb. You see what I'm saying? And the herb having the particular properties to unlock things inside. So you're talking, it could have been a psilocybin, not extract, but infusion. You know what I mean? It could have been an ayahuasca. It could have been a mescaline drink. It could have been a cannabis tea. It could have been a mixture. It could have been an LSD thing as well. It could have been any of those things. But regardless of what it was, they were trying to have you believe that the ancient one was the one that initiated his trip, but it wasn't. It was the tea. He got the tea before anything. Okay,
right.
He wasn't even looking at her in her eye or in her face, or even knew she even existed when she was pouring the tea. That's how deep it was. His attention was so fixated on this Asian cat in the lotus position to the side, to his right, he was all on him. Oh, you must be the ancient one because you look Chinese, you know, and we're over here in Asia, and you got the whole get-up on, so you must be the man. All the while, his cup getting filled up, and he don't even know it. And that's how it be in life. You know what I'm saying? Your attention is somewhere else. You don't even know who's really giving you your blessings. You don't know who's really giving you the things you need because your attention be on something else. And then when he turned around, the tea was already done. You know, he sipped it. And then when he got done drinking it, he said what was in there. And I think he said ayahuasca. I think he said mescaline, LSD. He said one of the two, acid. He said two different entheogen names, but the audience takes it as a joke. They like, oh, funny, ha, 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 ha. He was saying something was in the tea. Yeah, something was in the tea. That was their way of telling you it was the tea that's going to take you on these trans-dimensional journeys in order to find out who you are.
Yeah, I wish I could remember the name of this documentary I saw, and they were talking about DMT. And
dimethyltryptamine.
Yeah, and they did like a study on it, and the comments of the study participants thereafter were all really similar but vastly different, if that makes any sense.
Because they're all customized based on what you're going through in your spirit. Everybody has their own thing. Some people have real bad trips because they have a lot of evil, a lot of darkness in them, you know, or the way that they think, the only way that their higher selves can properly communicate the message to them is through some demonic entity or some weird-looking creature, because that's how it's translated, you see? Dreams that you don't understand, like a polka dot koala bear that's like roasting marshmallows on the moon, like you'll be like, what? Like, what does that mean? You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But what it is, it's your mind trying to make the sense of this high frequency info on the low vibration that you operate on when you're up. You see, and when it converts it, you know, the same way if you don't update your computer and you try and download something from an email and you got the old computer so it doesn't look as dope as the other person's computer because you got to operate off that operating system, it's that same thing. So when it gets filtered, it's a polka dot koala bear roasting marshmallows on the moon because that's like the only way it can communicate that to you, and you just don't get it, you know?
How do you improve
that, man? That's the magical question of the day. Well, you got to raise your frequency, you got to raise your vibration, and the main thing is to open up your mind. This is why I do Hollywood Decoded, because this is a way for people to open their mind up. You see, by using films as the foundation, everybody's open because it's a movie. You know what I mean? It ain't too deep. You know what I mean? I'm not going to be too serious. We're talking about film. You know, it's like a book club. You know, we all going to talk about, you know, how we, I'm curious to see some symbols in the movie. So it's open, you see? And the minute that your mind is open, then you can receive more. You see, you can understand more. I can take you on a trip. You see, if we just deal with factual evidence and it's just a lecture, just on this point, that point, and the third, it's more structured. It's more regimented. You see, this way, I'm including pop culture into the mix. You see what I'm saying? Which is a necessary thing because pop culture is part of our mythos now. You know, it's just what it is. You know, Kanye West and Spider-Man, like, that's part of life. You know, people talk about these things. I don't care if you don't believe, you don't listen to any Rihanna. You know who she is. You're going to see her face. She's going to influence things around you one way or another. So I want to use the culture that we're dealing with as a teaching tool, you know, because as I talk to youth and I speak to people younger than me, that's what they're watching. That's what they're dealing with. I listen to their music, too. And it's so crazy I say I listen to their music. That means I'm, like, getting older to say something like that. But for real, yo, I used to be the most bougiest stick-up-the-mud cat when it came to hip-hop. Like, you know, if you wasn't Black Thought or Dre 3000, like, I'm cutting your head off. Like, you had to come with some real content. You had to come with some real wordplay. You know, you had to respect, you know, the hip-hop founders that came before you, and if he was on any of that other stuff, it was like, that's the Fisher Price, Dr. Seuss nursery rhyme. I ain't with it. But I had to open up my mind. I had to open up my heart. I had to open up my ear and start listening to what was happening. And what I was hearing was like a resurgence of a primordial like vibration that we haven't heard in a long time. And that's what's going on with a lot of this music now, is there's a lot of tribal beats, a lot of tribal tones, a lot of chants. Now, the content is reflective off of the youth and what they got to go through. So I'm tired of the elders and everybody banging on the youth, and they need to wake up, and they got to stop talking about this. Back in my day, you know, we said it more discreetly and with class and blah, 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 blah. But these youth are a direct reflection off of the households they come up and the environment that they live in. And if you decided to give in to this structure and to this society, if you decided to give in to that and sacrifice the well-being of your children going through their rites of passage and becoming who they're truly supposed to be, you can't be mad that they popping off the side of their neck and they tripping and they wilding, because they are a reflection of their spirit and what it's going through. And the music is going to express that. So you need to listen to the music. You need to listen to them. Listen to them. Dance with them. See what the hell they doing and stop being so quick to criticize, you see. So, you know, I'm not saving the world or nothing, but I figured through using pop culture as a reference, using movies as a means, I can create this direct line from high science, metaphysics, occultism to what they talk about, which will give them some type of interest and hopefully inspire them to do some research and find out some things on their own.
That's dope right there, bro. And it just kind of like solidifies the importance of the imagination.
Yes.
You know,
Thank you. Say that word again. They're what?
Their
what? What's
it
called?
Imagination.
Their imagination, which is something that we get like, yo, we get it raped up out of us, man. We get it is raped out of us as we get older. We just keep getting this same narrative about how the world's going to be so dark and so cold, and you got to prepare for it, and we don't have time for make believe, and you know, get out your head, stop daydreaming, stop imagining this and that. And then when you get older and you go through your job, your cubicle, and you're 40 or 50 and your hair's graying, and then you like go to like seminars and you start finding out how you really make money and wealth, and you come to find out that these people talking say, imagine, visualize, be more childlike. Mm. So you like you sacrifice your childhood, you do everything all these old fogies tell you to do, and then when you get all crickety crackety, you know, when you're older, you know what I'm saying, they want to come and now tell you to revert back to a child again. Like, what do you mean? You should have just let me be that guy. You see what I'm saying? So Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood was that dude, man. He put you on that trolley, he took you to the land of make believe. You see what I'm saying? Because in the land of make-believe, guess what? He was a king. He was royalty. He talked to animals. That was his world. So what is your world? In my world, I come from a people that are great, that were never enslaved, that are ingenious, and that are have the potential to become supernatural entities at any moment in time, because we're in that time frame now. That's what goes on in my mind. And I use these films as a way to really show people how we are superpowered. Right now. Right now. We're just like Clark Kent stuck at the desk. We went on break too long and forgot we were Superman.
Facts. That's dope right there. I like that one. I'm going to have to use that one.
Chewing on the pencil like, what was I doing again? Like, huh. Let me just write this story again. I'll just write another story. Oh, it's very real.
Yeah. Do me a favor, bro. I'm not the biggest expert on metaphysics.
Right.
If you could break it down for the learning challenge people like myself.
Yeah. No problem. And I do that. I speak as though people already know what I'm talking about, but I do that because it arises the question. And then when the question comes up, I know what channel to go down. Now you ask me that question, boom. Beautiful question. What is metaphysics? Well, the word meta means beyond. And we all know what physics is. You know what I mean? Physics is really the study of how things work. You know what I mean? Like their inner dynamo. What are the mechanisms that gear things to work, you see? So metaphysics just is talking about that principle of that study, but beyond it. So you know, you'll hear people say that's pseudo because there's no reason why metaphysics matters. It doesn't hold any footing right now as a people with our children getting killed in the street. Like, we shouldn't be wasting our time talking about metaphysics. But, hey, white people call metaphysics quantum mechanics, and I don't hear nobody talking nothing about that. What do you think quantum mechanics is? That's beyond physics because every single definition you have in physics does not hold water in quantum mechanics. It's a totally flipped sideways reality other than the mechanisms that make up physics as we know it, or Newtonian physics. You know what I'm saying? Based on Isaac, you know, and then the apple falling on him, gravity and all that stuff. But
right.
Metaphysics just mean beyond physics, okay? To give you a good example, if I go back to 1960, right? Where they was boycotting the buses, and we walk in from one spot to another, and I pull out my smartphone and call an Uber. They're gonna what the dude? What is that? Like, you just pulled out a piece of glass and you just was swiping and what? And then a car pops up to take everybody home. Like, they're gonna be like, yo, he's a sorcerer. He's a magician.
Right.
He just pulled out this little thing and like pressed. It was amazing. And that's only because they, at the time, are not going to be able to understand the technology that drives the device, the organization in place for the Uber to come. You see, they're not going to understand all that. So in their head, it's magic because they don't understand the steps. So that's all magic is science that you have not understood yet, okay? So there's a difference between a magician and an illusionist. An illusionist casts illusions and sleight of hand to fool you in your eyes. A magician is really a scientist that is doing scientific phenomena that you don't understand yet.
Wow. That's deep right there. Yeah, I definitely have seen some illusionists. I can't say in person I've seen a magician. I definitely would like to do that.
You're a magician. Listen, first of all, let me ask you this question. Where do your thoughts come from?
Oh, good question.
Where did your thoughts come
from? Damn, that's a my brain?
Huh? I'm just saying. No, your brain is just a machine that does what you tell it to do. And it's like physical. Is there a hole in your brain where thoughts come and sit there and wait in a waiting room like a doctor's appointment until they need to be seen? You know what I'm saying?
I got you.
Now, that's one question. Let me ask you another question. Let's say there's no one in the room right? And you start thinking. You start going over your day. Now you're talking to yourself. You know you're talking to yourself because you recognize your voice, though you're not speaking out loud. You're speaking in your head, right?
Now, right.
If you chose to scream, you can scream in your head to yourself. You can whisper in your head to yourself. But there's no medium that's being vibrated or disturbed by a sound or a voice. So how are you speaking and talking in your mind where you can raise your volume and lower your volume, yet there's no sound?
Man, I've never considered that.
And this is a third one. How do you send your blood cell, right, which holds 350 million hemoglobin proteins in each red blood cell. How does one red blood cell containing 350 million hemoglobin travel through 60,000 miles of blood vessels, enough to wrap around the earth 2.5 times in a minute, every minute of every day since you've been born? How? So, magic occurs every day. You visualize the type of woman you want to be with, and you run into her at a concert. Huh?
Can you help me tweak that visual? No, I'm just messing with you.
No, I'm just saying. How do we do these things? Huh? How do we do these things? How do we gain awareness in our dreams, which is called lucid dreaming, and study certain things, and then come back to this reality when we wake up with the knowledge of what we had in the dream? I've come out of dreams with cuts before based upon things that happened to me in the dream. I'm like, wow. I must have just, like, angled my fingernail the right way to just kind of, like, slice my, okay, while I was sleeping. All right, I guess that's what happened. But we have all these things that take place in our lives that we experience with other people that we have no explanation of, no scientific backing for it. And all that stuff just gets dumped into the magic bucket. Oh, it's magic. Because that's kind of a glossed over terminology. But we come from a magical people, all right? Voodoo, Payo Mayombe, Santeria, all these different principles, even in Christianity, when they whip out this Bible and they read Psalms, like, it's incantations, it's call and response, it's meditation, where you're using your intent, you're using your voice, and then you're following through with action, and the universe responds to it. Look, the universe is a canvas, okay?
Mm-hmm.
A canvas responds to the intent, the art, and the paint that you put on that thing. You can make a beautiful picture. But if you don't do anything, the canvas is just going to be blank. It's going to be blank. And if you do a bunch of garbage, you're going to have a real horrible image that you're going to create on that canvas too. But if you take your time and you breathe and you're beautiful and you channel the inner light that's inside of you, you can make one of the most glorious works of art. The universe is the same way. Except as opposed to it just being this flat 2D construct for you to splash the paint on, this thing is multifaceted, like a diamond. So you can paint on so many surfaces.
So does that tie into the multiverse, or is that totally different?
Nah, I mean, that's what it is. That's what the movies is, a multiverse. Why do you think they call them multiplexes? How many theaters do you go to now to show one movie? Like, they got 16 and 24. And you look through the list, you got Jason Bourne, you got Moana, you got Star Wars, Rogue One, you got Doctor Strange, you got The Arrival, you got Trolls, you got Almost Christmas. Look, these are all different realities. These are stories, right? Mm-hmm. Allegorical tales to give you morality and teach you principles, but they're all different realities that you agree. Like, when you sit in a chair in a theater, you agree it's real. Because there's no way you're going to enjoy that movie and properly go on that journey if you don't give into it. You have to give into the gunshot. You know they acted. You know that dude didn't just die. Right? But why are you crying?
Right.
Why are you crying? Why are you crying because Grandma Tala turned into a stingray in Moana? Why did you cry? Why? Huh? Why are you hurting? Why are you hurting because the young little girl with cancer who shaved the hair off. Why are you crying? Why are you mad because homeboy just cheated on old girl and just lied to her in her face? What you they acting? Because you participate, and that's what we keep forgetting with the movies. When the people don't understand, we are participating in this thing. And there are billions of people that go to the film, including my people of all shapes and sizes, ages,
right.
Okay? So I need to be able to talk to them because I watch movies too. So I'm like, okay, if this is something I know that we all do that transcends religion, it transcends ideologies, because
mm-hmm.
you'll have an atheist will go to a movie about God in a minute, okay? You got
mm-hmm.
you got people who are super racist. They'll go to a Will Smith movie because they like
right.
Will Smith for some reason. I'm saying it's like, I used to watch Fresh Prince back in the day. This is the only person of color I'm going to watch. You know what I'm saying? It transcends everything. Like, you'll go in a movie and run into somebody and be like, dude, why are you up in here? Like, I didn't even think you was on this tip, you know? So it shows a lot about people's psychology, like who they really are. You know, and then to just hear people's take on films when they come out, like what they saw, what they got from it, you know, it's very, very, very powerful. And as I've been talking on these numerous shows, when we go to school, we talking the Ivy League, Cambridge, Oxford, Harvard, Yale, composite university, let's say, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to take literature. Okay, and most literature
right.
that you study in school that is not an elective, okay, this is something that you have to do, is filled with stories, people. These are not nonfiction either. It's not reference. They do not go over history. They have their own thing. Call history for that, social studies for that. You go to literature, they're talking about fictitious tales from people's imagination based upon true human experience. And they use this in order to get people to understand more profound and more deep concepts. Because when you do your book report, when you
mm-hmm.
do your dissertation, it has to be filled with everything other than just the basic synopsis of the book. The professor wants you to dig deep into the symbolism of what this character stood for and why they did this and how they did that. And this was a parallel of this in history and how they show that symbolism between this point and the color of the this and the tone of the that. So if that's with books and they got these super skillful college courses off this where you get degrees, then why when I want to do it with a film, which is actually books on a higher dimension, all of a sudden it's seen differently. And that's because everybody is fooled into believing that movies are entertainment. And that's
that
the
is
first
true.
Mistake.
That is very true. How many movies do you watch?
Say that
again.
And,
matter of fact, let me retract that question. What when you sit down and you say, okay, I want to decode another movie. What makes you choose a particular movie versus another one?
Oh yeah, it's something that goes on, you know, in the trailer or when I read the synopsis of the film, you know, seeing what the storyline is or the actors, you know what I mean? It depends. It's different reasons. The Arrival got me because I saw it was being released on 11/11. And for anybody who doesn't understand what's so important about that, 11/11 is a dimensional communication tool. It's like a breadcrumb.
Mm-hmm.
You know how Hansel and Gretel had to leave the breadcrumbs to get back to grandma's
right.
house? 11/11 is like breadcrumbs from a higher dimension to you to kind of give you confirmation or allow you to know that you're moving in a particular direction. It's like
okay.
a wake-up call. It's like a stimulus. And anybody who's listening, I know they see this on their clock with numbers. It might not be 11/11. It might be 12/12. You know, it might be 3/33, you know. But they see these same numbers repeating all the time. But the number 11/11 represents a gateway. It's a portal. It's an entry point into something else. So when they have films come out on this day, they're usually very important. So that was the first thing. The second thing that stood out was the fact that the movie had to deal with an alien encounter different from what I've seen ever before, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the difference was the aliens weren't here to just rape and pillage, okay? The aliens came, and the first step we did was establish proper communication, like you're supposed to do in court. You know, like you're supposed
mm-hmm.
to do in any other situation before you get caught up in an argument. Somebody come over to you, man, I can't believe it, man. I saw you with old girl the other day. Well, you ain't seen me with nobody. So you commit to the argument, like, off the rip. Instead of observing the fact, dude, he breathing all hard, okay, he mad, you see his eyes all beady, he's sweating. So you like, okay, dude's outside his mind right now. So whatever he's saying, I can't really take it at face value because he's just, like, upset. Okay, so he tells you what he's talking, and then you kind of, like, you don't have to even address that. You address what you were doing. You address, oh, how you're seeing how he's reacting, and you know, man, you all right? And through doing it that way, you neutralize it, and then dude's not like that no more. You see what I'm saying? So
mm-hmm.
establishing communication is very, very important, and that's what they talked about. And more specifically, not verbal communication, but visual communication. And as a people, we can understand that because in all of antiquity, all of our ancestors left all the information we need visually. There was no verbal recording, okay? Like, I can't go inside Chichen Itza, you know, or the Great Pyramid and press the play button, and I'm going to hear, like, a Saw or Quetzalcoatl or Montezuma give me the instructions on what to do during the eclipse. Like, I ain't
right.
gonna hear their voice like that. I'm gonna hear them inside me after I take this in Theogene. You know what I'm saying? But what they left for us were the symbols on the walls, okay? Because symbols are able to encompass so much information in one thing. It transcends time. See, speaking is a duration. Because you record from when you start talking to when you end talking. But see, when you're writing, a symbol transcends time. It's above time, it's beyond time, and it's multidimensional. So, you know, between those particular points that I was getting privy to with the film, that really pulled me in. And I'm glad, because when I saw it, it just provided so much for me to use to show people, you know, what is happening right now, you know, in consciousness.
Mm. And I know, Sean, I know you had a question, bro. You still there?
I'm here.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh,
okay,
yeah, I'm right here.
Go ahead, man. Get your question in, bro.
Oh, yeah, I wanted to know if you still in Detroit. I know you had went down there to help the people with Flint, right? And you had set up some things. You still down there and doing those things?
Yeah, I'm actually about to leave from Detroit to head to New York because that's why I'm here. You know, we're about to do this event on Saturday at Nicholas Bookstore, so I'm about to head there. But I'll be coming back here, and I'm actually going to be doing a Kwanzaa dinner. Y'all got to forgive me. I'm supposed to have this flyer done by now, but I've been real busy getting ready for this event. But I'm going to be doing a birthday celebration for Dr. Kiefer Witherspoon at Sankofa Life. And it's going to be her birthday is on the 31st. We're going to be celebrating her birthday. And in addition to her birthday celebration, we're going to be celebrating that day of Kwanzaa, which is Kaumba, which represents creativity. It is the magic again. And I'm going to have the full spread of the vegan food. So it's going to be a ticket. And when you come in, it'll include the event and your meal, which will be like a spread. Like, you might be rolling out the door when you leave, and understand, like, you don't need no meat, you don't need no dairy in order to have a delicious, savory, soulful meal. So that's what I have coming, you know, for New Year's Eve. But until then, Nicholas Bookstore, 1396 Fulton Street, Saturday, 6 p.m., that's when we're going to be in there rocking with this event. And for those that can't make it physically, go to eventbrite.com, type in KT the Arch Degree. The triple feature flyer will come up. You could buy your ticket, get your seats. So you can see it high definition from the comfort of your home. But
no doubt,
yes,
man.
About,
and what
about
up, though, to my people
Detroit
in Detroit?
To
sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, bro. But what up, though, to my people
ahead.
In Detroit, man? I was born and raised there, man, so I got to shout out the city.
Oh, yeah, the D is where it's at, man.
No doubt, man. No doubt.
It's just, the only problem is it's cold, boy. This Winters, yeah. Man, Winters is a big thing, is a monster. But once you get by that winter, that spring, summer, fall, man, it's heavenly. It's like, yeah, man. It's like another world. Yeah.
Nothing like home, bro. And you know what? I got to say the same thing for Harlem. We went there, I don't know, what was it, a month and a half ago, man. We got to go back during the summertime because it was amazing, and it was 60 degrees outside, 50 degrees outside. I can't even imagine what it's like when it's 80. Man, such a beautiful spirit.
Yeah, I grew
there.
Up in New York, so I had, you know, I was in Brooklyn and in Harlem. Brooklyn, I had some good times in the neighborhood. That was back in the day when you could have block parties, and it was like, I don't even think you had to check with the city or nothing. Like, I don't know how they did it, but they'd be able to lock the block off. They put the little police horses up, you know, the wooden horses, and you'd turn on the fire hydrant. Whoever the
right.
smallest dude in the neighborhood was would whip out the baked bean can, the family size baked bean can that was cut open on both sides, and you turn the fire engine, the fire hydrant on, and it'd be on like high power, and he'd hold the can and put it to the jet stream, and it shoot the water up, and then you got a fountain that took up half the block. But it would have mm-hmm. to be whoever was the Debo of the neighborhood because he had the strength to use that water. You know what I mean? I remember I tried to hold that can one day, man. That thing went ping, ping. Yeah, man. But no, I came up in New York. I came up in Brooklyn, and I loved the environment there, man. Like, I had some great memories there. Central Park, Prospect Park. Clinton Hills, Myrtle, you know, and I came up, like, not knowing, like, I'm looking up, and the people who was leaving out, you know, when you're younger, the cool people that leave out, they're moving and shaking, that was Red and
right.
Blue, that was A.A. Rashid, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
These were the people that was, like, my, like, big brothers and big cousins and the people I was, like, living around and looking up to, and they, nah, little homie, you gotta hang back. Read them books. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And
oh,
that was, yeah, exactly. No, but no, I'm glad they did. They did that for a reason. They had to go down through a path. I had to go down through a path. And now here we go meeting each other where our path gives us particular strengths that actually fortify each other. You know,
right.
So
I mean, you get it now,
but
you know,
that.
At the time,
yeah,
like, man,
but not at the time.
I wanted to get
down with the action, man. They was
right.
jumping the trains, the graffiti, and the, man, they was getting there, man. But it's all good. It is all
you
good.
Know, man, that's the beautiful thing about life, though, man. It's the growth process.
Definitely,
you know,
that's what it's all about. It's all about growth. It's all about reaching to the sun, because that's what growing really is, ain't it? It's about getting closer and closer to that sunlight. That's why plants grow. That's why everything reaches up high. It reaches up high to get close to that sun. So if that's what you do your whole life, you got to make sure the food you put in your body reaches for that sun just as much as you be reaching for that sun. Now, something that's dead is not reaching for the sun. They reaching for that earth. They reaching to go back. You know what I'm saying? So unless you're trying to go back into that soil again and, like, strengthen up some trees, if you're trying to be here, then you need to partake in things that are imbued with high quantities of electricity, you know?
You know what? I think you brought that up. It was a lecture about detox. I can't remember the full name, but you did.
Oh, detox, diabetes, and digestion.
That's exactly the one, and you broke down.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, and I've been in quite a few science classes over the years, but I don't think I've ever seen anybody break down just the cell and the plants as effectively as you did.
Oh, I had to. I had to tell people they were cannibals, man. We don't know we're cannibals, because the Creator was so awesome where he gave us a choice. See, there's two eukaryotic cells. Okay, you got prokaryotes. You know what I'm saying? Which is the bacteria and all that. You got Monera. You know, you got all these different kingdoms or whatever. But when you get into the fungi, vegetable, and plant, in a human, an animal rather, you have something called eukaryotic cells, okay, multicellular organisms. So we have the option of consuming vegetable eukaryotes, fungal eukaryotes. We're not supposed to eat animal eukaryotes because that's who we are. So I wanted to show how plants are these energy storage devices, energy generators, that they are the source of true power, you know, and it's like I have to go deeper than the deep, because I would come up and people would ask me why. My mother was like that. You know, I'd bring her something and she would be like, okay, so why? And I think I'd know the answer, but I wouldn't. Because when she would ask me why, I'd be like, I don't know, I'm about to make something up right now. So so yeah, I got used to that. I got used to that and digging deep and asking myself why. Okay, so it does this. Okay, why does it do this? Okay, it does this because of this. Why does it do that? So when I give my presentations, I ask as though, I mean, I present as though I've been asked why 1,000 times. You see what I'm saying? And no, I don't answer the why all the way until the nitty-gritty, but I usually go deep enough to at least get people, you know, a good foundation. You know what I'm saying? And they're going to find out this Saturday when I go, and they ain't going to have no idea that when they come and see me break these three movies down, the type of information, I'm going to be going into Trump. I'm going to be talking about, I'm going to be talking about melanin. I'm going to be getting genetics. We're going to be talking about, like, just everything, just the information that is necessary, because we are at a point right now at this time of the year, rolls around every year, where we get next to Sagittarius constellation, and that's where the galactic center is, and that's where we get imbued with the most potent and powerful energies, what they quote-unquote call downloads. So if your antenna is not clean, if it's not open, then you're not going to pick up those subtle energies that are coming down here to give you the information necessary. You know, so I'm using these movies as a means to disseminate everything that's going on right now and just give people some real powerful knowledge. It's one thing to say we superheroes. It's another thing to give people, like, info on how to become one, like, in this lifetime, like, not, like, three generations from now. You know, right. And I'm gonna be breaking some powerful concepts down, man.
That's dope. That's really dope. I'm kind of kicking myself, and I'm gonna have to miss it because I'm in Cleveland now.
Oh well, like I said, it's online. You just gotta watch from the comfort of your home.
You are right about that.
That's what
Make
I'm saying.
Sure you tag me
because
in the link too,
bro. Yeah, eventbrite.com. Everybody's listening. If y'all can't come to Brooklyn, New York, I mean, a lot of people are coming because the debate is the next day. They're coming to see SETI and Pharaoh go in with the Amun-Ra squad on the whole evolution concept. You know, Sarnetta and them are throwing that. So everybody's going to be in New York anyway. Okay? So
you got
what
a winner?
I'm saying
you picking
the
winner?
Four. I mean, there ain't no competition right now. Look, anybody who is pumping Charles Darwin is not on my list. I'm sorry. I can't get with Charles Darwin. I can't get with us coming from monkeys, okay? And a lot of people don't even know. Like, I had a conversation with the Amun-Ra squad about a year and a half ago. This is when we were about to do the evolution conference, which I was a part of. I'm crazy because I say we come from plants. You know what I'm saying? But that was my breakdown at the event. It's still up on YouTube, and I got a lot of positive feedback from my presentation. People really got what I was saying. You know, it was definitely on a high level. But prior to this evolution conference, I was asked if I was locked up for 40 years in jail and didn't get any booty, would I consider having sex with an ape if an ape was present? This is what they asked me. Like, this was
what?
A question. I'm like, what
Are
does this
serious?
Have to do with anything? No, I'm dead serious. And listen, that's not the craziest part. The craziest part was the fact that I said no. They thought I was retarded because it was like, nah, man, you going 40 years without none, brother? You could, man, that ape girl gonna be looking real nice. I'm like, what? This is the future of the community right here. This is where we headed. Like, come on, bro. I'm like, if I have the option of having copulation with an ape, monkey, primate, whatever, you know, or being abstinent, then I'm going to be abstinent, bruh. I'm going to use this time to go inside and figure out how to get up out this prison. That's going to be my main thought, not having sex with a monkey, you see? So there's a very, like, damaged, like, psychology in a lot of us, and we're not even aware of it, and we're, like, contaminating our people. So I'm definitely not about no monkey past, you know.
Man,
becoming, like, my mama was not no gorilla, orangutan,
What type of person even thinks of some shit like that? Like, that's just...
Listen, I don't know. And it's like, I refuse to think about it too long because I don't even want the answer to that. I don't want the answer. Like, keep that. You know what I'm saying? So, when we talk about evolution, remember, first of all, the problem with the evolution conference was the audience was not educated in regards to the definition of the term, which means prior to us even getting up there, we should have been very forthcoming in regards to what the definition of evolution is and who is for it and against it. And you got evolution from the standpoint of Charles Darwin and natural selection and that whole coming from monkeys type deal. And then you got evolution, which most people think of where, oh, man, with my spiritual body, if I do what I need to do, you know, I could walk through walls. I could, like, fly. I could, like, read minds. They think of evolution as a progressive abilities. You see what I'm saying? Of the human body and our experience. But that evolution is not the evolution of science. When they talk about evolution, they're not talking about people that can now read minds and stuff. No, they're talking about green and yellow beetles, okay? They're talking about the fact that there's a tree, and the tree got green moss on it, you know what I'm saying? And the green beetles are able to blend into that green moss, and then those trees die. So now the green can't blend into the tree no more. So they eat all the green bugs up, and the yellow bugs start proliferating and like take over, and boom, natural selection. You know what I'm saying? So they use that as the framework. But that's all based on us starting on Earth, like here. Like, what about prior to this? What about civilizations before Kemet, before floods, before destructions and cataclysms? What was we on then? You know, so... The evolution conversation is a necessary conversation. Charles Darwin don't need to have nothing to do with it because he wrote this book in the late 1860s, right during the Civil War. We know what was popping at that time.
Right.
Like, come on, let's stop it. You know what I mean? So, you know, I don't even have to go too deep into it, but when it comes with it, man, I already know Pharaoh gonna come with some fire. Say you gonna come with some fire. Hopefully it'll stay with the science and the information and not get all personal and distractive. You know what I mean? That's what I'm hoping for. I'm hoping for the science. I'm hoping for the facts. I'm hoping for the information to inspire the people. And regardless on what side people are on with it, I think coming together, you know, they're going to bring a lot of that information forward. So, you know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought there was So it's evolution. I thought it was Demeter Netter. I butcher names, so if I pronounce that incorrectly,
well, yeah,
meta,
yeah, it's evolution and the Demeter Netter origins. It's all mixed in. It's like connected. It's connected.
Okay, all right.
But that's what I was under the impression of. Yeah,
I got a totally different lane of questioning. Before we went to Baltimore. I'm always tell this story. I'm not a vegetarian, not any stretch of the imagination. So
right.
With Keith Brick and Keith's brother, and like, let's go to this vegan spot because they all vegans. Brick,
right?
Getting there, I guess. So I go in there, man, and I eat this catfish tofu, man, and it was horrible.
Right.
Like for a neophyte in a vegan restaurant. What would you recommend if you just had, I got to get this person to like this food? Because that just turned me off so bad that I'm like, eh, on the whole vegan thing.
That's like
the vegan murder burger. Yeah. A big fan of the murder burger, by the way.
Well, this is the thing. This is kind of like, I don't know, like referring you like to a clothing store to get a shirt. And I'm just like, you know, just pick a red shirt, and it's like, it depends on the designer, it depends on the cut, it depends on what red, like, you got all those factors involved. Like, I don't know who's in that kitchen. I don't know who's in that kitchen. Just because that thing vegan don't mean it's going to taste good. See, people think that when we talk about vegan, and when we talk about eating healthy, that we're also saying to sacrifice taste and texture. And the experience of eating along with it. No, not at all. That's the exact opposite. Like, I cook, man. I know seasoning. As a matter of fact, Mama Pill, a lot of people don't know this. Mama Pill is a chef. Like she has a certificate. She's a chef. She went to the Natural Gourmet, which is a cooking school that, man, people don't just, you get selected to go there. You don't even choose to go there. She ended up going there when I was a child. I remember when she graduated. So she's actually a gourmet chef, my mother. You see what I'm saying? So the meals that I came up with, she dealt with getting different types of herbs and spices, different types of fruits and vegetables, not the run-of-the-mill apple, pear, broccoli, cabbage. You know what I'm saying? Like, she expanded my palate, my mind in regards to aromas and fragrances and taste. You see? So my knowledge of cooking came because I got the background with her, my grandfather, who was a cook in the military. He's from St. Croix, but spent a lot of time with the Trinidadians. So he had a lot of that infused in his cooking. And him, and then on my father's side, I also have some chefs, some cooks as well in the past. So it's not all me. It was something that was in me. And what was the catalyst was my impatience because, you know, my mom was cooking for all of us, you know, doing the mom pill thing, you know, solo style with it. And I would, like, get impatient about, like, food and stuff. Like, when I wanted to eat, I wanted to eat. But I would have to wait for mom to go to the store and then the. So she educated me. She was like, okay, well, you cook. If you think it's so easy, if you can't be patient and just wait for me to go in here and do this thing, okay, bet, you cook. And I was like, all right, I will. I surely will. And lo and behold, I got to learn real easy how difficult it is to cook. You know what I mean? And the difficulty just lies in the steps. You know what I mean? Step by step. You know what I mean? And it's timing and it's confidence and it's smelling and being patient and looking at everything. I started off with spaghetti. So I got so good at it, it was like the family would have to like wait for me to cook the spaghetti. I did it from scratch. Like no spaghetti sauce in the bottle, in the glass bottle out of the supermarket. No, I started with tomatoes, you know, the onions, everything. I just didn't do the noodles, you know what I'm saying? But I started cooking, you know, at a young age. And just looking at the Food Network, looking at one of my favorite ones was Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives. And even though 98% of the places he went to was just strictly flesh, meat, pork, beef, see, I didn't get emotionally distracted by the fact that he was a meat eater. I was looking at the chemistry and the processes that they would go through in order to impregnate all these things with flavors. So I was like, I'll just replace the pork shoulder with this. Like, you see what I'm saying? But follow the same steps. So I tell people that. I'm like, listen, they'd be like, what do I do? And then cook. And then cook. Like, why all of a sudden, because there's vegan ingredients in front of you, now you're like, oh, my God, do I put it in water? Do I sit it out in the sun? Like, do I, you know what I mean?
Let me rephrase the question here. You got one meal that you can cook to convince somebody that the vegan way is an awesome way.
Oh,
what meal is
barbecue jackfruit sandwich. Barbecue jackfruit sandwich with purple cabbage slaw. Yeah, you bite into that bad boy with a side of my vegan macaroni and cheese, you're going to be like, meat what? Dairy who? And you say you came up in Detroit. So the only thing you got to do is just holler at some of your people that's up here and be like, yo, you been to any KT events and had any? Matter of fact, no. I'm tripping. Just call Keith. Call Keith. He's the first one in line all the time. At every event that I do when I got food. Trust me.
I'm hesitant.
Hit him up and ask.
He ain't going to stop, right? Keith ain't going to stop there, though. You know, come on, bro. Let's go to this other spot.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's the problem, man. You got a lot of restaurants out here that are vegan restaurants, but they're not cooks. They're not passionate about it. You see what I'm saying? Like, somebody will bring a plate out, and if it ain't right, I'll tell them what to do. And then they'll bring it back out, and it'll be dope. And everybody be like, yo, what's that? You know? So, yeah, man. Cooking is – all this is chemistry. All this is magic. You don't think making a cake is magic? Where you take all the separate ingredients, you make a liquid batter, you add some heat, and all of a sudden you got this fluffy little dessert with icing on it? Like, really? You don't think that's magical? That's
that
magic.
That depends on who makes the cake. I've had some
over
the years.
Oh, I've had some. Hey, even if the cake is nasty, it's still magic. They still change those phases of that medium from it being separate powder, liquid, all that, to one liquid substance, it being this fluffy solid substance where it's all together, everything's married. You know, but yeah, you do have these rare instances where people really know what they're doing, and that cake will take you somewhere.
You know?
But I just say that in regards to all the foods, man.
Like the first person, like what were they on to sit down and marry those particular ingredients to make
a cake?
That's
what I'm saying. That's the magic. That's what I'm saying. That's the chemistry. Like all the stuff that we cook, the different meals and things like that. Like who came up with a souffle? Like who thought of that? You know what I'm saying? A paradise pie, like what Aries Latham does when he does the raw pies. You know what? Who came up with that? You know who came up with ice cream? Who came up with the potato chip? Who came up with macaroni? Like who came up with macaroni and cheese?
That's, I know about the potato chip.
Who
that was George
that? It was a brother. Yeah, it was a brother that came up with that, right?
Yeah,
brother
and
came up with potato chip and ice
too.
Cream.
He was being petty when he made them potato chips.
But it's always
it was a brother that was a
stuff.
Chef, and he had a customer that was complaining, and so he decided to basically burn the potatoes and cut them real thin. Come to find out, they were a big hit.
That was
one of our questions.
Look at it now.
Definitely magic,
right
though.
There. Oh, yeah. We're magical beings, man. I'm telling you, you know when somebody's looking at you, when they're standing behind you, you turn around, you like, what the? And you know when it's a good vibe or a bad vibe. You know when somebody's talking all slick to you in your face, but they really lying to you, like in your eye, you feel that. Like, we got so many magical things that occur that we don't pay attention to, we don't focus on because we're too distracted with all the rest of this. A 9-to-5 run-of-the-mill stuff. When we don't spend any time going in, because to go within, to study our body, to study our spirit, to study our emotions, to study our anything that's inside of us gives us so much more information than anything that happens externally. Because the book you find that really gives you what you need to know is really based upon something you're going on inside of yourself, and you attracted that book to you so that you can make a better sense of something that you're going through. So it's all inside. That's where the magic lies.
So let me ask a question. I was listening to you on Nota Ledge. I think it was like last year. I was listening to it, and you said you was gonna do a lecture, and in the lecture you was gonna take us on a journey. You know, like the magic school bus through the body.
Oh, yeah, I did. It was a fantastic voyage.
Is it out there where I can find it?
Yes, it's on my site. It's on HollywoodDakota.com.
Okay, Hollywood.
Yeah, HollywoodDakota.com. Yep, The Fantastic Voyage. And that's the movie everybody should go see. It came out in the 60s. Where there was a scientist who had some military information, and he suffered a stroke. And when they took him to the hospital, they found out he had a big blood clot near his carotid artery, but it was in such a position that if they did any type of medical practice on him, he was going to die. So, of course, they always have the answer to it. Well, there was an experimental military operation similar to like Ant-Man, which just came out, where they were able to shrink, miniaturize. So they miniaturized this team of this military team along with these scientists to inject them through a needle into the guy's body. And they traveled through his body fighting white blood cells and all types of other stuff in order to remove this clot, so that this doctor can gain consciousness and provide the information. So this is the book, and they're supposed to be redoing it. You know, they got a couple of directors lined up. It's been like in production for like 10 years now because they haven't really like figured out what they wanted to do. But that's going to be a powerful film whenever that thing drops, because to show the inner space, man, that's one of the most powerful journeys you can go on visually.
I actually saw that movie, too. That's a crazy movie.
What, Inner Space or Fantastic Voyage?
The Fantastic Voyage.
Inner Space.
Okay. Because there's Inner Space, too. That was a comedy with Martin Short where they did, they had the same thing. Yep. And that, yeah, they had that one, too.
Yeah, now that I think about it, I did see that one, too.
That was the old one, like, you know, that was the interesting thought. That was the one. I can't wait till they redo it. You know what I'm saying? Don't be surprised if y'all find me up in there. I might be one of the people on that submarine. I might be one of them on there.
I was passing, man. I see what they had to go through, bro. I don't know if I want to do that one, man.
You know what I'm saying?
You know,
that was
traveling through the body. That was crazy, man. Just the natural function of the body was just detrimental to them.
Yeah. But I have to get ready to wrap it up because I'm about to head to New York. I'm actually traveling tonight, and I knew that if I didn't do the show tonight, like, it'd probably be difficult for me to do it before the weekend. So I wanted to make sure I was able to set a little time aside to get this in. But I definitely want to come back where I have, you know, the whole stretch of time, and we can really go in. We could just do a health thing where I go through the body. We could talk about a couple of things, you know, so that people could really understand, you know, how magical, you know, they really are.
That would be dope, man. Come on, man. You know you're welcome on our platform anytime, bro.
I appreciate you for having me, man.
Hell, it was an honor and a privilege, man.
I
appreciate your time, man, and the wisdom.
Thank you. I want to let you know also you're very essential. We need, you know, you're very essential in the community. You know, the work you put in with the health and helping people get their health together, and outside of that with the films, you know, and looking deeper into ourselves, you know, that's really needed. And
that's
your blessing.
Thank you, brother. Thank you both. Thank you all. Thanks everybody out there.
And just before, I want everybody to know, you can check his website out, www.kttheartsdegree.com.
That's right.
Make sure y'all support the brother in the event this weekend and beyond. Salute greatness when you come in contact with it. Definitely an honor to have you on, man. And check out the groups, My Skin Is My Sin and All Black Everything, and the website, MySkinIsMySin.com. Shout out to Liberation Minded Media, man. That's the family. That's the home base. Always an honor and privilege, man. No doubt, man.
And
it's
for those that
bro.
Are looking for any further info, y'all go to YouTube. Just type in KT the Arch Degree. Go to Instagram, KT the Arch Degree. And on Facebook, I'm Kamani Tate, KamaniTait. And any for further inquiries, for packages, consultations, things of that nature, you could email me at luvgreenlife@gmail.com. That's Love Green Life, luvgreenlife@gmail.com.
And I'm gonna put the episode on our YouTube channel. That's My Skin Is My Sin.
Oh,
also,
perfect!
That'll
be great.
This weekend, so I'll tag you when I post it.
Okay. Did you have the flyer? I can send you the flyer too.
Oh yeah, definitely. Send me the flyer, bro. Yeah, I get.
Yeah,
you know,
I'll send it to
you. Definitely put that out there.
Perfect, perfect. Yeah, man, I had a blast tonight, man. I'm going to come back. We're going to have even more fun next time.
No doubt, man. Definitely, man.
Talk about some herbs.
Be safe
chemistry.
Travels, man.
Oh, no doubt. We're going to have a good time this weekend, brother. And I thank you again.
No doubt, man. Have a good one.
Peace.
Peace. That was a really dope interview, man.
That's a fact.
You know, and he explained things in a way that somebody as limited as myself could understand. So that, and I think that's crucial.
Yeah, because he could take it there. He can go there. He can go there, man. I mean, I enjoy listening to him when he go there, because then it forces me to go a little harder with, you know, like, let me look into this. I got to check this and that out. But, you know, I think... for him to first come on here the first time, we gotta, take it easy. Work.
Right. You know, like the medical terms, you know, because I've been in that profession for so long, you know, it's a little easier for me to kind of grasp where he's going with that, you know. But a couple of things, you know, it's like, oh, when I was looking it up on the video, I'm like, But he explained it in such
a
digestible way that
yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay, I don't feel as dumb.
Yeah,
definitely.
You know, yeah,
definitely. What was the name of that? That burger he was saying.
You remember? That blew my head. That part blew my head.
I typically
barbecue
write shit down and I forgot. Barbecue Jack something.
Jack for yeah, barbecue.
Yeah, I might have to check into that. But
yeah,
once again, man,
together.
I definitely want to. We only got like 10 minutes left, man. So I definitely want to again, man. Just shout out KT, man, and definitely thank him for coming through, man. Definitely was a nice build and informative. You know how we try to do, man. Anybody got any shout outs, man? I think we might as well wrap it up a couple minutes early. Unless anybody got any questions or comments out there that's listening, 347-855-8692. Press 1 to get on. If not, I don't see anything. We'll wrap it up a little early. I don't know what y'all doing over there, man, but damn.
Yeah, you good, Rome? You know what I'm saying? I got a special set of skills, you know what I'm saying? You all right? You being kidnapped?
Right, you know what I'm saying? It doesn't sound good over there. Hey, before we go, man, we do got a call. So let's take this 7404 right quick. What's good, fam?
What's
good,
fam? Peace. Man. That interview was dope, man. KTC bringing it, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, definitely. What's going on with you, though, man? How's life?
Man, it's cool. I'm just in traffic right now. You know what I'm saying? I just wanted to give you a shout-out, Liberation Minded Media shout-out. And
no doubt.
Plug the show's coming up. Plug the show's coming up this weekend.
Who you got?
We got Minister Inky coming up Sunday, 4 o'clock on the East Coast. We're doing something for the West Coast, you know, being a little bit of history, going into the black history of California, Oregon, and Washington.
That's dope. It's
powerful.
Oh, and this is Jay Dizzle from Black Eye Stand Radio, if y'all ain't know already. I'm pretty sure y'all did, but those two people that didn't know, now you do.
word.
That's right. Man, Johnstown, man, you be putting it in on all kind of levels, family. I appreciate you more and more, you know what I'm saying?
Come on, man.
You know what I'm saying? The interviews, you be going in. Y'all be going in on this. My skin is my sin, man.
Appreciate that, bro.
We just talked about it. Appreciate that.
We're trying to get to your level, Jay.
Man, don't go backwards, family. Don't go backwards. I'm trying to catch up with you, man. You know
yeah, you out there hanging out with DMX talking about don't go backwards. I see you, bro. I see you.
Playing with me, to tell you the truth.
Huh?
Yeah, we need that interview, son.
Man, we're going to try to make something happen this weekend. I was really pretty much working, so I couldn't really kick it like I wanted to, but... You know what I'm saying? This weekend we got the little old school, you know what I'm saying, little old school concert, Snoop, and who else is going to be there? All kind of cats going to be there, man. We got to try to get some exclusive something.
That was very, very dope. Yeah, that's Snoop exclusive, man. Yeah, definitely. Tell him we got the network, man. We want to holler at
him. Yeah, I
want to see where he at now. You know, because I think he did kind of went back from Snoop. He was Snoop Lion. You know, I don't know. It kind of seemed like he done backed up a little bit.
Well, I don't know. You can only really know when you check the vibes. You know what I mean?
Fact.
But I'm still going to be on the captain looking at two short down here. Digital
breaking up a little
gonna
bit.
Okay. Now, I said, there's going to be a live cast. We're going to make something happen out of it. You know how we do.
No doubt. Already.
That's how we do.
Yeah. I ain't got no doubt about that. Mess around, have Snoop, Dre. Shug from the pen. Wait a minute. Is Shug still living?
I can get the guy who plays Shug.
Good.
Good. Good. Good. Good.
Two. You know what I mean?
What? Hey, wait, but which one, though? Wait, what is the couple? He was, Suge was in a couple movies, wasn't he?
Yo, all right. Quick story, yo. Quick story. True story. Yo, my cousin's an actress, right?
So,
my cousin moves to L.A., gets a role on General Hospital. This is around, like, 2005, 6. Gets a role on General Hospital. So she's at the General Hospital party in Vegas. And my cousin, she a hippie. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, she a straight-up hippie. She don't listen to rap, none of that. So they had the Vegas party, and the chick that she came to the party with got in a fight. Yo, Suge Knight smacked her, right?
So, I'm sorry, man. That's just wrong. That's wrong. I said, I'm sorry.
So listen. It gets funny. So the Suge Knight smacks the chick. So my cousin, being, you know, a little pretty light-skinned chick from Baltimore, you know what I'm saying, like, she starts jumping in and swinging on Suge Knight and has no clue who this dude is. You know what I'm saying? So,
damn.
Suge Knight being Suge Knight, he chokes her out.
Oh, wow.
My cousin out. So, yeah, so after
was
it
was
after it, yo, after it happened, she ended up, because it was in, like, TMZ or something. Like, you can Google Suge Knight chokes out chicken club, and my cousin pops up. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Bruh,
word.
I don't know
word.
If hell actually exists, man, but if it does, bruh, you are on your way for that story. Like,
this is a known fact. This is public information, bruh. I ain't speaking on something that wasn't already known.
But you don't know how should be choking for me. There's a video
with
her dancing behind a chick choking up.
Yeah.
Word.
How have we regressed so much in like 2 minutes, bro? We went from greatness of KT to Suge Knight choking your cousin out.
Yo, oh, you see what happened when Jerome get on the show, bro?
Right, right. Bro. Oh, man.
Yeah, bro. True story.
Oh, my goodness, bro. All right, man. So on that note, man, don't forget to check out the groups All Black Everything. And My Skit Is My Stand. Oh, and I forgot, man. Don't forget, check out the group Liberation Minded Media. And trust
Big
me, say we got some stuff planned for next year. That man, I'm gonna leave it at that. But
right.
Trust and believe, you know, we are taking our narrative back. Period. You know,
that's
we got a really, really, really strong team on all fronts, and we riding together. You know, and it's a beautiful thing. So
right.
Shout out to Do the Knowledge Radio, Black Eye Stand Radio, the Rundown with Renee.
That's right.
Get this wisdom magazine with Shakti. Shakti Sense, My Skin Is My Sand.com, Renee Black Graphics, and if I'm
word.
Missing something, help me out. But I think I got everything.
You in
there.
Yeah.
Shout out 300 Gangsters.
300 Gangsters.
Key Development.
Boom said it.
Already.
I was about to say something else. Oh, BlackJunction.com. And New Black Knowledge on YouTube. Don't forget to check us out on YouTube, My Skin Is My Sin. On Instagram, My Skin Is My Sin, the number one. Twitter, by the same handle. And Liberation Minded Media, also on Instagram. And I think that's about it. I hope so, because I'm exhausted.
One more time. Go to Eventbrite, type KT the Arts Degree. You know what I'm saying? So you can get in tune with that lecture he got coming up. Yeah.
That would be dope. And I think that's it. Y'all got anything? Y'all signing out? Y'all good?
Hey, man. Stay black. Be safe. Catch you next week.
Stay away from Suge Knight. Peace, fam.
Peace.